Radio Lecture.
Right. Thank you very much. Good morning, my dear listeners. Welcome to our second year students reading Principles and Practice of Teaching. That is PNP, EDC 232. This morning, we'll be looking at whether teaching is an art or a science. And because I want you to follow whatever presentation I'm making in a very systematic manner, I'd like us to look at what teaching is. When you are done with that, we shall look at teaching as an art. We look at teaching as a science. And then we find an answer to the question, is teaching an art or a science? Yes, we have gone through teaching maybe from the basic level through to the highest level that we find ourselves. If you ask someone what teaching is all about, the person tells you that you might not know something, somebody might help you to know it. And that is teaching, that act of helping you to come to know of that thing you didn't know early on is what is defined as teaching. Well, we see teaching as the impartation of skills to another person. So when an individual imparts information or skills to another, it is common to describe the action as teaching. Imparting may mean to share experiences or communicating information, like what I'm doing right now. So lecturing could be a part of imparting information or sharing experiences. Yet, different educationists hold different ideas regarding the concept of teaching. We see teaching as an intimate contact between a more mature personality and a less mature one, which is designed to further the education of the latter. So that knowledgeable person is helping the less knowledgeable one to acquire some information or to acquire some knowledge. We see that as teaching. When you peep out your window, you may see people selling. And the end result is that people come to buy. So we see selling to be related to buying. In similar manner, when you talk of teaching, teaching is to learning. When you teach someone, the end result is that the person should learn. So teaching is seen as the arrangement and manipulation of a situation in which there are gaps or obstructions which an individual will seek to overcome and from which he will learn in the course of doing so. Again, we can take teaching as a form of interpersonal influence aimed at changing the behavior potential of another person. You relate with that individual in a very friendly manner, so you can influence that person by way of helping him to change his behavior at the end of the day, because of that interaction that you have with that individual. Again, we see teaching as a system of actions that are intended to induce learning. That's why I said teaching is to learning, just as selling is to buying. Again, we see teaching as a system of actions involving an agent, an end in view, and a situation involving two sets of factors, those over which the agent has no control. For instance, if you have a class or a class size, that agent will not have any control over it. The nature of the learners or the characteristics of the learners, the agent may not have any control over it, and also the physical facilities, and those which that agent can modify. That agent can modify the techniques and the strategies that he will employ in the act of teaching. So in effect, teaching is an interactive process, basically informing, involving classroom talk, which takes place between teacher and students. And it usually occurs during certain definable activities. So that's how we see teaching. And we have Davis and Glasser, who have pointed out that the entire structure of teaching has four basic steps. They think of the first step as planning of teaching, which includes content analysis, identification and writing of objectives. With the second step, organization of teaching, which includes the teaching strategies for achieving the objectives of teaching. The third step is the identification of suitable teaching learning strategies. Suitable teaching learning strategies for effective communication of content. And the fourth step that they have identified is managing teaching learning. Managing teaching learning, whereby the focus is on the assessment of the learning objectives in terms of student performance, and this forms the feedback to teacher and student. So we did realize that teaching is a generic term which denotes actions undertaken with the intention of bringing about learning in another. You undertake certain actions with the main purpose of ensuring that the other party is learning from you. When you look at the IET, that's the International Encyclopedia of Teaching, International Encyclopedia of Teaching and Teacher Education, they have classified the concept of teaching into three categories. And these three categorizations are: one, teaching as success, which signifies that learning is implicated in teaching. Teaching entails learning and can be defined as an activity which necessarily affects learning. Secondly, they see teaching as an intentional activity. Teaching is seen as an intentional activity, which implies that teaching may not logically imply learning, but it can be anticipated that will result in learning. Teaching is not seen initially as learning, but it's expected that learning will come out of it. Thirdly, they see teaching as normative behavior. This denotes that action undertaken with the intention of bringing about learning. Teaching as a normative behavior, denoting action undertaken with the intention of bringing about learning. It actually designates a form of activities, training and instructing. In here are primary members, and indoctrination also comes in here. So to get all this together, we have Green in 1968, who says that training consists of activities that shape skills and other behaviors, whilst instruction and indoctrination go with activities which induce knowledge and beliefs. Over here, we say that teaching can be conceptualized as a form of problem solving and decision making, which has many properties in common with the work of, let's say, a physician. This conceptualization has led to a body of research which has investigated the decision making of teaching, focusing in particular on the information about students that teachers use to make decisions and the way they modify instruction to individual learner needs. If you look at the work of the physician, he actually studies the patient to know what is wrong with him, research into whatever is affecting the patient before trying and prescribing the requisite medication to cure that illness of the patient. In similar manner, in teaching, what we conceptualize here, we take decisions about what is to be taught, how it's going to be taught, and the set of people or the category of students that we are going to teach. What is learning behavior and what do we expect to be their ending behavior? We do all these to ensure that we, at the end of the day, modify the individual's behavior to ensure that the person has learned, and for that matter, we expect to see a change in his behavior every day. There are some features of teaching which I want us to note. That's the characteristics of teaching. First, teaching is an effective interaction between the teacher and the students. Secondly, teaching has various forms like formal and informal training, conditioning or indoctrination, and the like. Thirdly, teaching is dominated by the skill of communication. To what extent are you able to reach that student? Well, we expect that you go through the steps of communication properly so that you can actually identify the needs of the students and provide those needs to enable the students to learn from you and your the various activities that you set within the classroom or the teaching situation. Teaching is a tripolar process, and the three poles in here are that we have educational objectives, we have learning experiences, and we have change in behavior. So when we talk about teaching, we want to identify these three poles: the objectives, which you aim at achieving them, the learning experiences, what strategies that you are going to go through to enable the student learn. And as the student learns, we expect to see a change in behavior in that particular individual. Because of this, teaching should be well planned, and the teacher should decide the objectives, the methods of teaching, and evaluation techniques. Teaching is all about suggesting and not dictating. You don't dictate to the learner, but rather you are at the softer side where you suggest things to the student to lead the learner to learn. So we see good teaching to be democratic. Good teaching is actually democratic, and teacher respects the students, encourages the students to ask questions in course of the teaching, and answer questions and discuss things. The interaction comes in here. You are not commanding, or you are not in any way dictating things to them on your own volition, but you bring them into the act of teaching and learning, where you open a way for them to ask questions, answer questions, and then discuss whatever is going on in the teaching learning process. Per that, teaching provides the needed guidance, direction, and encouragement to the students. The process is about learning, and you ought to motivate that student to do the learning, irrespective of the level that you are teaching the person. For this, we see teaching as a cooperative activity, and the teacher or the agent should involve students in classroom activities. As a teacher, you are not doing the teaching and the learning at the same time. It is the learner that you are helping to learn. So you ensure that you involve that learner in classroom learning activities, such as organization, management, discussions, recitations, and evaluation of results. Again, teaching is a kind of sympathetic experience. Teaching should be seen as something that is kind and sympathetic. And a good teacher develops emotional stability among the learners. You have to put yourself in place of the learner and then ask if whatever you are doing is something that that individual can easily absorb and learn from it. So even though we are saying teaching is kind and sympathetic, in most situations, teaching also empathize with the learners, so that teaching and learning can go on smoothly and effectively, and as another person would say, efficiently in the classroom. So as it is, teaching is seen as something that is remedial, and the teacher must solve the learning problems of students. It is not a one-touch kind of business that people normally say that when the radio speaks, it speaks just once, but it's not like that in the classroom situation. When you have gone through a process and a student doesn't understand you, you have to replan and then help the student out. So teaching helps the student to make adjustments in their life. It is a professional activity, so it helps to bring about harmonious development of the students. You are bent on helping the students to learn. So whatever kind and sympathetic activities you should involve in the classroom to enable the students learn, you should employ those strategies to help the student to learn. Further, we see that teaching stimulates the student's power of thinking and directs them towards self-learning. If you are able to set your classroom so well, you help the students to learn. You increase their power of thinking, and for that matter, you are able to direct them towards their own learning. And if you look at the act of teaching, you realize that it is something that can be observed. You can observe an individual teaching, and you can analyze whatever the person is doing, and again evaluate the teaching as it is. Looking at teaching, yes, people do say that everybody can teach, but it's not like that. It is a specialized task. Teaching is a specialized task and may be taken as a set of component skills for the realization of a specified set of instructional objectives. So, culminating all that I have said to one, I'll say that yes, teaching is both acts as well as signs. But does this answer my question whether teaching is a science or an art? Let's take some little time to look at teaching as an art. We look at what the art is about. Art is the result of an act of human creativity. There are so many artifacts that we can see on compound, on the campus. The work of art that we appreciate anytime that we are moving around our campuses. And the magnificent one is the one we have at the North Campus. That student center, yes, the runabout at the student center. Everybody sees it. People stand there to take pictures. They appreciate it so much. They ask questions and they go around to find answers to set questions that they ask themselves. At times they're able to answer the questions on their own. So we see that art is the result of an act of human creativity where the material is selected or shaped to convey idea or emotion, also in the visual form. It is clear, you can see it, touch it and feel it. This is how a teacher acts in the classroom situation. When the teacher explains something, they do the same thing everywhere. You go to class A, the teacher explains. Class B, the teacher explains. Suppose they are teaching you a topic of mathematics. You might have observed that they teach in a similar manner. The class A teacher in teaching that same topic as class B teacher will bring in materials to be explored. The class B teacher will also bring in materials and enable you to explore, to get the concept. They explain, they try to portray a visual effect so that you could understand it better. When the P1 teacher is helping the students to understand the concept of addition, I think they form groups of sets and they can visually count the items in set A, count the items in set B, but the sum of the two they might not know. So the teacher again helps them to bring all these materials together and then count to find the sum of the initial two sets. For them to get the sum of the two sets and are able to translate this into writing form. If it's about a set of two items added to a set of three items, they form the set. Set A has two items, set B has three items. And they bring these two, that is the union of these two sets together, and then they are able to count all together the items that they have in the union of the two sets, and that translates to 2 + 3 = 5. The teacher builds that algorithm with the students and from there they pick it up, so that without even forming the visual sets they can find a solution to a given problem in addition in that manner. So we'd like to look at and understand teaching as an art. Teaching as an art demonstrates how the teacher uses creative ways to make the learners or the students understand the topic or the topics that he might be teaching. In this way, the learners also enjoy the learning. You are working together with the students. You have prepared that environment, that learning environment, with every necessary tool that the students will require. So you do the learning with them. And you find the learning to be full of fun and interesting. Here we are seeing the artistic nature of you as the teacher. At the same time, teachers need to possess enough knowledge before teaching the subject. You need to do a lot of research. Despite the fact that you are teaching P1, P6, or JJ3, you need to research into the subject and the topic that you are going to teach. And only then can you teach that topic effectively and understandably also. You don't just assume that, yes, I was taught this thing far back in my primary school days and I know it. You look at the situation you find yourself in our modern terms or in our modern situations. What are you doing to improve even upon how you were taught to enhance the learning of that student placed in front of you? So teaching is an art in that teachers must bring themselves fully into the teaching situation. It is the teacher's primary duty to verify the method and strategies that will work best for the students. You are with the students for some time and you know the extent to which they think. You know the extent to which they involve themselves in classroom activities that enables them to learn. So you have to make sure that the strategies that you are bringing into the classroom situation is something that the students are going to enjoy. Be part of that classroom work and learn. You know, you make learning to be a fun for students to enjoy as they learn the needed concepts. Some people do say that teachers are not at all any logical entity, and neither are they also standardized products. No, we can't. Even though we are in the college of education or we are in the university of education, the university is not making us something like robots where we are programmed to follow systematic things in a particular manner. Yes, we learn. Maybe you have learned the strategies of presenting a lesson. Everybody has learned it. But in trying to display this in the classroom, we exhibit things in a different manner. But the end result will be the same. So if any strategy is working for one teacher, it is not essential to work for others. What works for one teacher may not work for another. So all the teachers should adopt their unique teaching strategies. There are things that we expect to see you performing. The other teacher in the next classroom will be performing the same activities, but the strategies might be different. So all teaching strategies that you learn should be adopted and adapted to fit your particular teaching situation and your personal teaching style also. So in order to be an effective teacher, you must carve out your own teaching philosophy. Your beliefs about teaching, how do you carve them out and discover your own unique talents and learn how to use them? Some teachers may think that through questioning, students can understand concepts better. Another may think that if students manipulate objects, they learn from it and come to terms with the concepts in a better manner. And for that matter, that is the way they teach or they strategize in that manner and present their classroom teaching activities. You should also discover your philosophy about teaching and work with that so that your students can understand you and learn better. Teaching as an art in here demonstrates ways in which the teacher may use creative ways to present the material. So it is fun and interesting for his or her students. Some examples are the teachers or a teacher using games, using hands-on activities. At times, due to the situation you find yourself, you could even bring in some movies that relate to the topics that are being covered. These are the strategies that you can employ to ensure that your students can learn and learn better. So it's like every teacher has a unique style of teaching. No two teachers can teach the same way. They work on their skills and the output. You understand what they are trying to explain to you. So as teachers, we must make sure that the strategies that we adopt will be something that will lead to the learning of our students. So per this, if you look at what we have talked about, what would you call it? Would you say it's an art? And here you agree with me that yes, at this point, teaching is an art. So to sum up the bit about the art nature of what I have talked about, you realize that if you are presenting in the classroom for it to be seen as an art, you must be creative. Whatever you are doing should be relational between the students. Feeling and empathetic comes in here. You are seeing teaching as expressive, and you are seeing teaching as something that is intuitive. It is a very social activity. Even though the students will be seated and you are standing in front of them, that gap should not be something that is so wide. You have the opportunity to go to them and interact with them. You motivate your students, and you should have in mind that the work that you are doing in the classroom is not following any routine or formula which you are going to be stuck to say that this is it and I have done it. No. You ought to be dynamic. Here we want to look at how we can learn that art of teaching. How do we learn the art of teaching? Learning to teach is not a challenging task to do. No one is perfect, much as the art of teaching is concerned. When a teacher becomes a teacher, that is when you have gone through your university education or your college of education learning, you do not know how to teach the students from the start. Or even situations where you are given the opportunity to go on internship. It is you are not having that experience of teaching, but rather you go out there and you learn. You actually come into the profession and you learn by accepting the challenges and learning through your mistakes. For instance, at internship, where we prepare you for the outside world of work, should your mentor or a supervisor point out something to you, it doesn't mean the person hates you, but rather helping you to identify your mistakes so you can learn from the profession. And when you are let alone, you will be capable of identifying your own challenges and work them out to help improve your teaching and affect the learning of the students. There are some things you should remember as a teacher, whether in the process of becoming a teacher or an already trained teacher. As a teacher, your responsibility is so huge. Look at the hairs in front of you. And these hairs are going to various homes. So you are everywhere. You are creating the future of tomorrow. So you need to know about the subjects and a particular topic you are teaching. You should have the knowledge into whatever you are teaching or whatever you are presenting. So we request that you research into that particular topical area. It will help if you research the topic and you collect in-depth knowledge about it. It is only then that you can teach effectively. Next, we request that you be a friend. In a classroom situation, be in a friendly mood. From your own experience as a teacher, you were a student someday that is gone. You never liked that teacher who was so strict. It continues today with every individual or every individual learner. No student likes a strict teacher. Students prefer to maintain a distance from strict tutors. They feel hesitant to contact such teachers. If you are such a kind of teacher, then you should change your mind. I'm not telling you not to be strict in here, but you should know which is the right time to act strictly. Every time if you are strict, your absence will be like a holiday or a blessing for the students. And it is not a good thing for you. So we expect that you be in a jolly mood so that students can approach you with their challenges whenever they want to. Be open to them. In the classroom teaching learning delivery, we expect that you ask questions. You should be a kind of teacher who asks questions often in between the lectures or the teaching situation. It will help you to know whether your students understand what you are teaching or they don't understand. When you ask the questions, certain things will be exposed to you and you can adjust yourself so you can help the students. So you ask questions and you ask students also to ask you questions. This most of us do not do in the classroom situation. We are in authority, therefore whatever we are presenting, when we present it, the lesson is ended and that is all. You should create situations where we should allow the students to access questions, because this will make the students feel confident during the question section in the classroom situation. In the classroom situation, we expect you to be interactive. Teachers who interact in the classroom while teaching is most favorable to the students. They like you so much. People will think maybe you are from the same family, but that family has been created in the school situation. When you interact in your class while teaching, students see a friend in you. They open up with you and start sharing their issues with you without fear. Because research has come out with the fact that fear is the major issue that is being the major problem between students and the teacher for a very long time. Students might not understand a particular concept, and because of fear of the teacher, they keep this challenge to themselves, and it might not be resolved anywhere in their lives. And for that matter, it goes a long way to damage them. So if you are a teacher, you have a very great opportunity to change this kind of picture, to ensure that your students are with you at all times. Albert Einstein once said that it is the supreme art of the teacher to awaken joy in creative expression and knowledge. So when you want to awaken that joy in your classroom where you will not even get tired of teaching, we expect that you interact very well with your students. Allow them to teach. When you have presented a lesson at a point in time, you can allow somebody to come and present something similar to sort of explain further what you have taught them. And the little that student will present in class, his colleague students will understand it even better than you presented, because they see that their friend has been able to acquire that concept and is explaining it to them or helping them also to understand it in similar manner. This strategy will be very helpful for you, the teacher, and the students also. When you ask your students to teach in the class, you will understand that the students have understood you or not, as their friends also enjoy what their body is doing in front of the class, their own mate is doing. Whereas it will be beneficial for the students, as this will boost up their confidence. Yes, we are able to do the same thing that teacher is doing. They are so confident, they have understood the concept, and they are working with it. If you are not someone who has been using this in your classroom, your initial steps will not be so welcoming to the students, because how would you expect them to come in front where you, the teacher, have been standing to express themselves to their colleagues? But you can do this or try practicing it, and it will become part and parcel of the students. So as a teacher, your responsibilities do not stop in the classroom only. You have to perform many more tasks than what you do in the classroom. But remember the points that we have said, because they are essential. Try to implement them, and you will see how it is benefiting or beneficial to you and the students. And it will also help to increase the relationship between you and your students. It will improve at all times. Right, so far we have talked about teaching as an art. Now let's turn our attention to the other side of the same coin, where we are seeing teaching as a science. We have gone through teaching, we have gone through learning, we have done science, or learnt it, or we are still learning science. In the learning of science, what do we observe? We realize that science can be stated as a study of something that can be examined. It can be tested, and again, it can be verified. So if science can be examined, it can be tested, and it can be verified, how can it be related to teaching? I hear you can recall that the teacher always studies the situation, and then they examine what they can do. This alone proves that, yes, teaching is both an art and a science. Because we have early on said that with science, you examine, you test, and you verify. And we are seeing all these things appearing in teaching also. If a teacher doesn't show both of these types of teaching methods, it will not result in effective teaching and learning. So, as I explained, the definition of science says science is anything that can be tested. Teaching is a science that shows various ways in which a teacher may use a more strategy to deliver the material to the students. It is like a traditional way of teaching. The teacher is using a scientific approach where he's using a strategy, not one, not two, to deliver the material to the student. Suppose the teacher is teaching in a classroom. The topic is serious and important. But if the teacher is teaching only with the bookish language, without adding any realistic data, and without putting any effort into understanding them, imagine how the class will be like. Of course, the class will go boring. There could be that other teacher in another classroom. A teacher is using the same topic, or is teaching the same topic, but they have implemented a way of their teaching. They have studied the topic in depth, have collected enough data, and are demonstrating it to the students so that students can visualize it. It is very similar, if you look at it, to the scientists. And if that is similar to the scientists, then of course we will say that teaching is related to science, because this is how a science is related to teaching. You have your data, you put it to tests, you demonstrate, and you try to sift out the results. In the course of the demonstration or your experimentation, you see things visually. If I should add that, you see things happening, you do your observations, and in teaching, all these come in. So we see teaching as a science in that there are strategies and practices that a body of research has shown to be effective in enhancing learning. Just like say the medical doctor, teachers use research to inform their practice. On the individual level, teaching is seen as a science in that teachers are constantly gathering data by observing their students in order to see if learning is taking place and how they learn best. That is how the students learn best. And like scientists, teachers experiment with new techniques or strategies to see how they work. Maybe at college or at university, they are told that they should use real objects in presenting their lessons so that students can learn best from that through the manipulation of those objects. where they don't have the real objects, does it mean the lesson should not come on? They still have to teach the lesson using materials. So they go for a secondary material. That is, let's say drawings or charts, which will represent the real objects. And with this also, the students are able to explore. So you realize that if they modify their techniques or strategies, they don't just do it, but they employ the idea of science in making sure that these things work for them. That is teaching and learning move on smoothly in that scientific manner. They are able to identify students who couldn't perform. How do they do this? They can't enter the child's brain, but through the output of that child in that particular topic, they are able to identify that the child has a problem, and they will research again to find a suitable mode or a suitable strategy or approach to help that student or that learner by taking the learner through some remedial teaching for him to come abreast with the other students. So we are seeing teaching to be scientific in this manner. So in summary, let me say that teaching is an art and a science. And you now know that teaching is really associated with art and science. As an art, teaching lays stress on the imaginative and artistic abilities of the teacher in creating a worthwhile situation in the classroom to enable students to learn. My dear listeners, second year students learning PMP, this is something that you should have at your fingertips. Teaching as an art lays stress on the imaginative and artistic abilities of the teacher. How do you adapt and adopt a certain strategy? You need to be creative, because the students you are teaching in town A are not the same students you taught in town B. They are different. So you ought to be creative in your classroom so that you help the students to learn. And as a science, teaching sheds light on the logical, mechanical, or procedural steps to be followed to attain an effective achievement of your set goals or objectives. So we see teaching is a scientific process, and its major components are content, communication, and feedback. What have you prepared for the student to learn? Of course, it comes from the syllabus, but to what extent are you making it possible for the students at that level to absorb that particular content? How do you reach your students? You do that through communication. And how do you get feedback from the teaching that you have presented? You take note of all these. So for effective teaching, it is essential for you as a teacher to use art and science. So you ought to use art and science techniques in your daily teaching as a teacher. The teaching strategy has a positive effect on student learning. The strategies that you adopt, they have a very positive effect on the way that your students learn. Yet, the teacher cannot be an efficient teacher until they have incorporated art and science in their teaching. So, in all, based on every necessary calculation, it is proved that teaching is both an art and science. With this, I draw the curtain close to close this session or presentation, and we'll be awaiting your questions and contributions. The studio lines are activated. You can call, you can WhatsApp, you can send messages through 0503-923158. You can also call the studio landline, that is 033-232-0201. You can also Facebook through Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM. Twitter at Windy Bay 98.3 FM, Instagram Windy Bay 98.3 FM, YouTube Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM, and as we earlier said on, we said that you can WhatsApp, you can text, you can send your messages through 050-392-3158. We are at the studio waiting for your questions, your contributions, and your comments. Thank you very much.
Thank you. 98.3 FM.
Yes, we have messages coming from our listeners, especially our second year students reading PMP. And this one coming from Ejumako campus, from Muhammadu Batubogri, who is full of appreciation for understanding the topic that has been discussed this morning. Thank you for listening to us, and I pray that you continue to read and everything will be so easy for you when you get to the classroom. Elizabeth Tamia also says yes, she has understood everything properly. Right, we thank you for being part of this morning's discussion. And Danny asked, he says he didn't understand the writings here. I think I didn't get that well. Can you say it again? Please, you said teaching as art and science lays stress and artistic. Well, maybe I'll have to get that better after reading through. Say thanks for this. It's well understood. Please, doesn't mean that is from Bismarck Buensi Mills. Buensi says, please, does it mean without an artistic / scientific approach, there can't be effective communication during teaching and learning? And I have Elizabeth Darkon, who is full of appreciation because she understood us so well. Right, let me take Buensi Mills's comment. You see, in the classroom situation, if we are doing teaching, then we expect that the outcome should be learning, as I related it to selling as it goes with buying. So in the classroom situation, if you the teacher, you don't prepare so well, you don't have any strategies to help the students to understand your topic or the concepts related to your topic, you can't find a way of making sure that you bring the inner outer of the student, then what kind of teaching are you doing? You see, so we expect that you prepare yourself so well with your teaching philosophy guiding you, said that you can exhibit whatever knowledge and skill in the classroom situation to enable the learner understand you and to learn from you through the activities that you engage them in. You are not merely being there to tell them stories, else the student will tell you that you are called teacher tell, because you only come there to impose your knowledge on them. You will tell and tell and tell. There's no style in your teaching. Students are just sitting down as stooges and are seen as receptacles where you are pouring your knowledge. That is not what we're expecting. But instead, we expect that you have your techniques, adopt some strategies that will help make the learning of your content very easy. Talk to them. Communicate with them. How do you communicate? You say it, I say it, we explain, we understand ourselves. And then we look at the feedback. Is the feedback the appropriate feedback we are expecting? If not, then we are bound to replan and reteach that lesson. Going to my friend, is it Bismarck? Here, Danny, please, you said teaching and art and science lays stress and artistic. That one, I'm not getting you properly, Danny, over there. But we are saying that if you want your students to learn from your teaching, then you should employ the skills of art and science in your teaching. Be creative. Make sure that you search for information. Make sure that you engage your students in the process of teaching and learning. You ensure that the students practice, perform, and learn from that environment you have created for them. Don't be that teacher who just comes in and just dictate things to students. We have said that your class should be democratic. So it is, you are not the only person, I'll say you are not a repertoire of knowledge where you are going to pour everything onto the students, but engage them in that artistic manner and in that scientific way so they can learn better. Thank you very much. I think we are not having any more messages, but we have said that there's something coming. All right. We are starting from Ejimakwu campus. Muhammadu from Ejimakwu says he is requesting us to go through teaching as a science again. Maybe he enjoyed it so much and we want to have an anchor of it. Another person from, okay, not indicated, maybe mathematics department from UEW campus, Winneba. I am Brad Suman from mathematics department. Good morning, sir. I sincerely thank you for such an artistic and scientifically induced lecture. Thank you very much, Bright Suman. Right, maybe I will be giving some few minutes from the studio director to take our dear friend through teaching as a science. Maybe it helps all of us. It is going to help all of us. All right. Initially, we say that science is something that can be examined. Okay. Yes, the materials are there and you can explore them, you can work with them, you can handle them, you can examine them to tell the nature of those materials. Whatever you have in science can be tested, and you can again verify these materials. So relating that to teaching, we are saying that in teaching, you explore whatever you are going to teach. You have your content, which you have actually delved down into the topical area to know the needs of the students and what you should present to them in line with that content. So if a teacher doesn't indicate what he's going to teach, and that whatever he's going to teach is something that he has gotten from a research base which is related to science, then of course that particular thing is not worth to be taught that student. We explain that by definition, science is anything that can be tested, right? And teaching as a science shows various ways in which the teacher may use a strategy to deliver the material. The student can be allowed to sit and listen, but we are saying that if they do so, they easily forget whatever you tell them. But they should work with material to ensure that, yes, they took part in it, and they will still remember, as the Chinese proverb goes, you hear just from the teacher and you forget, but when you do it, you can easily remember. And that is highly scientific. So whenever you have the opportunity to present a lesson, we expect that you identify the needed strategies and practices, which is as a result of a body of science. And just like what the typical science person does, and I remember mentioning a medical doctor, you as a teacher, you ought to research to inform your practice. Okay. On the individual level, yes, you can at all times collect information or collect data by observing your students. You know your students. Observe them to know what is suitable for them at that particular level, in order to identify if learning is taking place at all, and you find how best they are learning. All these are scientific. So you need to experiment with the various techniques you have at your disposal to identify which techniques are suitable to your students. Likewise, your strategies, so that they can learn best. Because if you go through teaching and the end result is said that the student didn't learn anything, then where do we stand as teachers? So you put theory into practice. You have to research on what works and what doesn't work as a teacher, so that you can apply all these to teaching. We have realized that science is creative, and also it is a social construction. You get a point? So we see that the teaching that we do, it moves in steps. Step one, then you go to step two, step three, then you go down to the point that you might have exhausted whatever contents are there. Then you summarize the lesson to bring meaning to the students. You can evaluate or assess whatever you do, and that is also scientific. And the approaches that you use, you can reuse that approach, because the approach is reliable. Scientific approaches are reliable. So that technique which you sat down to read into it to know that this technique is going to help me, or this strategy is going to help me, it is something that you can rely on in several situations. And as a science, there is empirical evidence, if I should say it that way. There is empirical evidence of whatever you'll be doing. So that makes teaching as a science. Maybe that can go on well with you, Mr. Muhammadu. But if still you are having a problem with teaching as a science, then I suggest you come into contact with us through our office line, or you discuss that further with your lecturer. We have another message coming from Daniel Bagbi from Social Studies. Today's presentation made me understand the topic teaching very well. Others think teaching is just easy. In fact, it entails a lot. Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much, Daniel. I hope you are going to become one of the best teachers, and you need to work hard, learn your strategies very well. But in all, you must be a master of social studies. Yes, be a master of social studies, and wherever you are, you can help your students to learn from you. Thank you very much. Yes, in all, we have looked at teaching as a science or an art. And as an art, we have stated that yes, teaching is an art because it demonstrates how a teacher uses creative ways to make the students understand the topic. In this way, the students also enjoy learning. They find the lesson or the learning to be full of fun and interesting. And as a science, we expect that you put theory into practice, you research on what works and what doesn't work, and apply what works in your teaching. Because we see science to be creative, and it is also a social interaction. And this is exactly how we see teaching to be. Teaching is procedural, just like how science also follows steps from one point leading to the other, so the result is identified. In science, we can draw conclusions, we can do verifications, we can assess. In teaching also, you can measure the learning that has taken place, and where there ought to be a remedy, you provide it. So you can evaluate or you can assess your teaching, and that is something that is related to science also. So I'll say thank you very much for your audience, and we make a way next week same time to listen to another interesting and important topic. Thank you very much. See you again. Bye-bye.
Windy Bay 98.3 FM.